Have you seen this? Okay, I've seen, I think, once. Okay, on the flyers, where they announce the eighth prayer, they say, we are going to start takbir at 7. And the prayer is going to start at 7:30. So fixing the time for takbir, okay, this is wrong. Okay, following this, some people would not start the takbir before the announced time. So some people, you know, people who haven't learned about Islam, they might say, oh, look, I'm not going to start the takbir until 7. So he's abandoning another sunnah of doing the takbir from when he's leaving his house. He says, I'm going to start at 7. And people do that. Since takbir should start from the time when a person leaves the house. Okay. A fourth bid'ah is this. We saw earlier that takbir continues on Eid al-Adha. So leave Eid al-Fitr now. We're going back to Eid al-Adha. Okay. Eid al-Adha, when does it start? It continues up until the sunset of the third day of Tashriq. You know, when you do the takbir for 3 days, you don't do it for Eid al-Fitr, but you do it for Eid al-Adha. So takbir of Eid al-Adha continues from the Eid day until the sunset of the third day of Tashriq. Right? Some ulama restrict this takbir to 3 rounds immediately after each prayer. Some scholars have restricted this takbir to 3 rounds immediately after prayer. So you might have gone to the masjid and the imam, on these 3 days after Eid, what does he do? He does the takbir. He usually does it 3 times. Okay? Immediately after each prayer, congregational prayer. As we have seen in Ibn Taymiyyah's quotation, this, however, should be avoided for 3 reasons. Okay, this should be avoided for 3 reasons. Why? Because there's no evidence from the Sunnah supporting this. It conflicts with the practice of the Sahaba, as we have seen in some of the cited reports, that they said takbir at all times without restriction. Okay, so it was up to the 3 days, and they used to say it without restriction anytime. Okay, it obstructs the people from saying their regular takbir after the salat. Okay, so what's more of a you know, what's sunnah, they abandon it. Now what's sunnah is to start the dhikr after the salam. Allahumma anta salam, inka salam, tabarak. You do 33. That's the sunnah after the salah. But if the imam does takbir of Eid, reminding the people to do takbir, they've abandoned that sunnah of doing dhikr straight after salat. Okay? Is that understood, brothers? Okay? Especially when you're leading the prayer. Okay? Yes, the sahaba would do takbir up to the third day, unrestricted. Anytime, middle of the night, morning, fajr prayer, anytime. But to restrict it after the salat, that's wrong. They should be avoided because there are 3 consequences to it. Number one, there's no evidence from the Quran and Sunnah to support this, nor from the companions. Number two, it conflicts with the practice of the Sahaba. Okay, so there's no evidence from the Prophet ﷺ, there's no evidence from the Sahaba. And we know that the Sahaba used to do takbir for 3 days, unrestricted. And number three, it obstructs in the way of the regular dhikr from salat. Okay. So this is with regards to the actual Eid prayer. Now the Eid prayer and the khutbah. How long have we gone for now? We still have time? Who wants to continue? Continue? Okay. The Eid prayer and the khutbah. The ruling of the Eid prayer. Attending the Eid prayer is an individual obligation. Fard Ain. This means that it is obligatory upon every Muslim who is capable of performing it. Fard Ain. You might have heard it's sunnah mu'akkada, but the correct opinion is fard ayn. Okay, for every Muslim who is capable of performing it. Number one, for the following reasons. Number one, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam performed the Eid consistently and commanded all Muslims to attend it in the actual musalla. And also, it constituted to a larger gathering of Muslims than any other prayer in the entire year. So it's only once in the entire year. Number two, the second reason why it's fard ain, an individual obligation. Number two, the Prophet ﷺ commanded the woman to attend it. The woman to attend it. Those who were, even who are not supposed to pray because of their cycle, Prophet ﷺ commanded them to attend. Okay? Even though they were exempted from attending all other congregational prayers, the women who are women generally, they're exempted from attending all other congregational prayers. They're not required to go to Fajr in the masjid. They're not required to go to any of the five daily prayers or the Jum'ah. But the Prophet ﷺ pointed them out for Eid prayer, even the ones who are menstruating. Okay? And he commanded the menstruating woman to attend despite the fact that they could not pray. They can't pray. Menstruating women, they do not pray and fast. Okay? So, because the Prophet ﷺ commanded them to attend, okay, from this we learn, or the scholars say, it's fard ain. Okay, when the Prophet ﷺ was reminded, all of you know, the woman, of the woman who did not possess any adequate garments to attend, he replied, let one of her sisters, in faith, lend her some of her garments. There was one woman who could not attend because there was no appropriate garment for her to go out in public. So what happened? The Prophet ﷺ advised, he said, do any of the sisters, let one of the sisters give a spare piece of clothing to her. Okay. Similarly, another report that the Prophet ﷺ said, it is obligatory upon every woman who has a garment to go out and attend the Eid prayer. Ibn Abbas reported that Allah's Messenger commanded his daughters and wives to go out to the Eid prayers. Okay. So the command directed to the woman as well. Okay, we learn that it's fard ain. Abu Huraira reported, and a third reason why we take this opinion that it's fard ain, individual obligation, is that Abu Huraira reported that Eid al-Fitr occurred once on a Jummah, Friday. So the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, two Eids have coincided. There was once in the lifetime of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam where the Eid coincided with the actual Jummah prayer, and the Prophet ﷺ said, two Eids have coincided, he carried on. Anyone who wishes may consider that this Eid prayer suffices from him from attending the Jummah prayer. As for us, we will surely gather for Jummah. Okay, so it is known that attending Jummah is obligatory or not obligatory for men. Obligatory upon men. The Prophet ﷺ would not have made it optional for favor of the Eid prayer unless the latter is obligatory. So they had the option. Okay, you can attend the Eid prayer or you attend the actual Eid prayer. If Eid prayer was optional, he would not have said, okay? He would not have given that option of attending Jummah. Okay? So he said, attend the Eid prayer, and that will suffice for you on the for the actual Friday, because two Eids have coincided. Okay. Who holds this opinion? Ibn Taymiyyah, rahmatullah alayh, Siddiq Hassan Khan, contemporary, a scholar from recent times. He said the Eid prayer is obligatory because the Prophet ﷺ consistently performed it. He commanded us to attend it. He even commanded the young woman, the virgins, the menstruating woman to attend, instructing the latter to refrain from praying, but to witness its blessings and the Muslim supplications. He commanded to attend the prayer. The commandment of attending the prayer indicates that it is obligatory. Obligatory. Among the proofs for its obligation, it is also that it overrides Jummah prayer, what we mentioned before. It overrides it, okay, when they both occur on the same day. A non-obligation can never override an obligation. That's a very important principle. A non-obligation can never override an obligation. Okay, that's a principle that you must understand. Okay, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, all of you know him, he said, we approve the opinion of the Eid prayer that it is obligatory upon every individual. The opinion that it is not obligatory is incorrect. Ibn Taymiyyah says this. It is incorrect to think that it's not obligatory because it is one of the greatest rites in Islam. More people gather for it than for Jum'ah and Takbir, it is said during it. Similarly, the opinion that it is Fard Kifaya is unjustifiable. Fard Kifaya means like a communal obligation rather than an individual obligation. So we learn, subhanAllah, that the Eid prayer is Fard Ain for both. For both. Now, regarding the date and the time for the Eid prayer, or the timing of the Eid prayer, once the day of Eid has been determined, the Eid prayer should be held on its morning. Okay, the best time to pray is shortly after sunrise. Shortly after sunrise, and this is the actual timing of the Eid prayer. And of course, any other things are very—it's common sense. There's no adhan or iqama for Eid prayer. This is an innovation practiced by some as well. Some countries or some individuals practice adhan and iqama for Eid prayer. Sutra for the imam, the description of the Eid prayer, all of you are well aware of that. So that's with regards to the Eid prayer. Now, missing the Eid prayer. Let's say you're late. Okay, since the Eid prayer is an obligatory prayer, voluntarily missing it constitutes to a sin. Voluntarily missing it. However, a person who misses it with or without a legitimate excuse, whether it be voluntary or, without an excuse at all, should pray 2 rak'at by himself or in jama'ah. Imam Bukhari said, those who miss the Eid prayer should pray 2 rak'at. The same applies to women who do not attend. Okay? And those who remain in their distant houses or villages, because the Prophet ﷺ said, this is our Eid, we people of Islam. So you have to do the Eid prayer regardless of where you are. Okay? Anas ibn Malik commanded his ex-slave, he had a slave by the name of Ubay ibn Utbah, to gather his family and sons and to lead them in prayers similar to that prayed in the city, even in takbirs. Okay? Iqrama said, people of villages and travelers should gather together and pray 2 rak'at like the imam. And Atah said, so Imam Bukhari is quoting this as evidence. He's quoting the tabi'in, the sahaba. When a person misses the Eid prayer, he should pray 2 rak'at. Okay? Now, so that's the actual lesson today, inshallah. So some of the issues related to Eid, we discussed the actual preparing for before the Eid prayer, the takbir, the adornments we spoke about, the actual prayer itself, whether it's obligatory or not obligatory. Okay. So jazakallah khair. However, there are two opinions out there. Majority of people follow that it's not obligatory, it's sunnah mu'akkada, but it is, if you look at it, the reports and the arguments that it is obligatory, and if you don't go to the Eid prayer, you must pray it. Okay. So jazakallah khair, inshallah, we pray that the remainder of the month, you benefit from it, and inshallah we'll see you back here in term 3 for the seerah program, inshallah. Any questions? Adam Rahman. Yes, so an annual event. Okay, so there's the linguistic translation and the Islamic definition. So the linguistic translation for Eid is that It's a day on which people gather to celebrate. Okay. Its plural is Ayad. Right? According to some opinions, it's derived from Ada, which means to return. So something that returns. Ada, yeah. Yeah? What's reported that he wore the red one, the red, reddish over, yeah. Nothing's been reported on that nature, but what's been reported that he had that red one for his Eid. So nothing's been reported whether he changed it, but from that we know that he had a special garment, and that's the red one that's been recorded. Yes. No. If it's, financially, if it's difficult, no. But to have a special garment, so from the garments that you have, obviously you have some formal garments that you wear, just set some aside, especially for Eid and Jummah. Additional phrases? Yep. Third one, timing. So the timing. Yep. And then there's a fourth one as well. So we had the additional phrases, the timing, and there's a fourth one, wasn't there? Yes, there was a fourth one. Restricting it. Yes, restricting it. Yes, like the Eid al-Adha takbir, restricting it after the actual prayer. That was the... Let me just double check, if I can remember correctly. So the fourth one is the takbir, which is related to Eid al-Adha. Continues on for 3 days, but restricting it after each prayer, as the Imam does, it's, yeah, there's no report for that. Sunnah mu'akkada, what's obligatory is the prayer. Yeah. So listening to the khutbah is sunnah mu'akkada. Yani it's highly recommended. Should be done is the actual prayer. Is the minimum, people then can decide to leave. But if you do leave, do not hang around and cause, disruption to the others who are listening to the actual khutbah. Yeah, so you look at the, the security and the safety of the people. If it's very cold, snowing, then you can move it indoors. Yeah, raining, indoor park, or indoor stadium. If that's the only place available, yeah. Remember, you'll have menstruating women attending as well. So, it's better to have out in the open. Or an indoor place where... So the most important thing is having it... where the most capacity can fit, especially in the winter months, indoor, large indoor places would. Combining the Isha prayers with the Taraweeh. So if you attend late, okay, yeah. So if you attend late and the Imam's praying Taraweeh, you just intend the Isha prayer and just add another two. Pardon me? Yeah. The pace? Yeah, so It doesn't matter if it interferes. So as you enter the masjid, they're praying Taraweeh, you join with the intention of Isha. Yeah. And then as the Imam says Salam, you stand up and you complete your two additional rakat for Isha. Yeah. Yeah. So that's no problem. That's not a problem, yeah. Yeah, you do the Isha first and then the Taraweeh. Yeah. You don't separate from the? Oh, okay, yeah, from the player, okay, yes. No, no. You go and actually join the Imam itself, yeah. Yeah, so because in the masjid you cannot have two jama'ahs. The Imam's leading the Taraweeh, you cannot have your own jama'ah. So you go join him. And you intend Isha with that, even though if it interferes with the actual. Yeah. No. They should, yeah. Two jama'as in one masjid should not be done. Oh, no. They have to do the Isha before. Yeah. Yeah. So, in between the lesson, you mean? Yeah. And just make that as, you don't recite Surah Al, just do the minimum. Because the Imam will start off for the second one, or the next unit. Yeah. Isha. Yeah. You pray your Isha, you complete it, even though if he goes into the second rak'ah, you complete your Isha. Isha is more obligatory. Yeah. So Isha is more obligatory. Then once you've done the Isha, you join the Taraweeh. And you can, if he's on, obviously if he's in his last tashahud, you don't join him there, join him in the next unit. So you're praying, you started off two units, Imam's praying two units, Allahu Akbar, he said the Salam, you get up and you do the two rakat for Isha. Your recitation becomes long, okay, the Imam stands up and he's leading in the Taraweeh, he's continuing on Taraweeh, you're still on your Isha prayer, you complete your Isha prayer. Even though if he's, if it interferes, doesn't matter. Yeah, even though it interferes, doesn't matter, yeah. Okay, Jazakallah khair, inshallah. We'll see you guys in term 3. How long is that? 4 weeks, yeah.